Ladies and gentlemen, our moderator, Shaheen, Attiq-ur-Rahman, is the vice chairperson of Bunyad Literary Community Council. She is, as you all know, the 3 times provincial minister, and her main work is with female literacy in Pakistan. And she has worked with various rural communities, as much as 300 communities. So with this brief introduction of her, I'll hand over the discussion to her and we'll move forward.
Thank you very much, and Assalamu alaikum to all of you. And I'm glad that you've kept the honor of Karachi. I mean, you people are supposed to get up at 10, but if you have come, it's excellent. You're not famous for being early risers, most of them. But anyway, it's a very important topic. I'd like to introduce you to Ruchira on my right. She has written this wonderful book, which we all can take, buy, and read, and understand, and feel. And of course, Fouzia Saeed is a very well-known person. She wrote Taboo. I think a very brave act in Pakistan about the women living on the other side. And she's also now a very big boss. She's head of Lok Virsa in Islamabad and doing an excellent job by trying to create humanitarian feelings in an unfeeling city of bureaucrats. So a clap for them. We have a lot of time today. I mean, we are going to break it up into 45 minutes. We'll keep on sharing questions with my two friends. And then 15 minutes for question and answers. But I'd like to tell you a small incident which I went through. How women are exploited, the worst so are the poor women. I was a spoiled kid of my parents, and I was traveling by bus from Multan to Lahore, and on the way with me came and sat a woman from Okara, and she was clutching a bottle. She was not more than 26. She was very, very young, and when she sat next to me, she was quite high. Not on drugs, but poverty, you could smell her frustration and all. And she sat and her tears kept on coming down, but no sound came. When I asked her, what's wrong with you? You know how we are urban people. We presuppose many things. And she said, I've got TB and I've got last stages, that is the third stage. And I will not live this year. So I said, so? Why are you crying? She said, I've got 3 kids. One I was still feeding when my in-laws threw me out. Because they said, if you give these children TB and the family TB, you will destroy us, so get out. I said, why didn't you go to your parents? She said, the parents I went to, they said, we have no space. So I said, where are you going now? She said, I'm going to sell myself in Patoki to anyone. I have to eat, I have to have a roof on my head. So poverty is the worst destroyer of alternatives for women, and that is what we are very grateful to Ruchira here, to show how she came into thinking of the people who live, the women, the voiceless, the faceless majority in this subcontinent, and how she got into this side, which we feel very shy to speak about. The women who men go to, and yet we women condemn them. Ruchira.
Thank you, Shaheen ji, and thank you to all of you in Karachi who've shown up early in the morning to listen to a topic which is discomforting and hard to talk about. I'll just give you a context of who I am, so you know I'm from India. My name is Ruchira Gupta. I grew up in Calcutta, one of the poorest cities in the world, with the largest slums, left behind by the British Empire from the Bengal famine, and also the city which has the largest red light area in the world, known as Sonaghachi. this red light district was also created under British colonialism at a time when syphilis broke out in the British Empire, and British soldiers and clerks were, you know, dying by the dozen. And the people, the authorities wanted to keep the soldiers in India to rule us, but they didn't want them to die of disease. So they created what is known as licensed brothels. And they brought in women from Tibet and from Nepal to these brothels. And they would renew the licenses of the brothels based on these women being subjected to health checkups. And you know, if the women were disease-free, license renewed. They created a law called the Immoral Traffic Prevention Act, which exists more or less in all the countries which are ruled by the British, where you know, there were licensed brothels. Customers were given very light punishments. Brothel managers and brothel keepers were given some amount of punishment if they broke certain laws, like keeping underage girls. And they also banned soliciting in a public place. So women in prostitution could not stand on the streets and solicit, so that those in the service of the Victorian England could say they were not promoting prostitution, whereas they were for their own soldiers and clerks. Fast forward, the reason I'm talking about that story is that as a journalist, I'd grown up in Calcutta working for a newspaper called The Telegraph. Many of you have heard of M.J. Akbar. He was my first editor, and you know, we all wanted to become the editor, and I would always ignore writing about women's issues because I thought covering women's issues would mean, you know, I would be trivialized, I would not go up the career path, and I wanted to be the editor. So I used to think that what happened to men was political and what happened to women was cultural. And so even though this big red light district existed in my country, in my city, I didn't even look at it. And it was only many years later that I was walking through the hills of Nepal when I came across rows of villages which didn't have any girls from age 15 to 45. And I began to ask the men in those villages, you know, why, where the women were. They were drinking tea, they were playing cards. And they said, don't you know, they all are in Bombay. Now, Bombay was 1,400 kilometers away. These villages were far away from the highway. So I could not understand how so many girls, how so many women could be in Bombay. And as a good journalist, I began to look for the answer. And the answer changed my life, because I found that in my generation, in my lifetime, in my country, the flesh trade existed. Mm-hmm. And there was a smooth supply chain from the villages of Nepal to the brothels of Bombay. And they were going on preying on these girls between the ages of 9 and 13, who were locked up in brothels for 4 or 5 years, raped by 8 or 10 customers every night. So I saw the problem first in a country which was not my own. But then I began to go backwards. I spent time talking to the women in prostitution in Bombay and began to see the utter dehumanizing of the prostitution system, as I began to call it, the deliberate exploitation of one human being by another. As a journalist, I'd covered war, I'd covered famine, caste conflict, you know, hunger, but I'd never seen this kind of deliberate exploitation of girls being raped, bottles being shoved up their vaginas, cigarette butts being put out on them, and just being used up, and all happening in plain sight. So I began to, I made a documentary, I won an Emmy for Outstanding Investigative Journalism. All the glamour felt very irrelevant. I was in a hotel in New York and I said, what am I doing? And I wanted to stop being a journalist and do more. So I did two things at the same time, and both my colleagues on the panel have also done the same thing. I joined the UN thinking that through the UN I could affect policy and change the world. And at the same time, with my award, I went back to the 22 women in prostitution in the brothels of Bombay. And I said, what should we do? And the women said, you've got to help us. I said, I've done what I could. I'm a storyteller, I'm a journalist. I've told the story, but I'm not a lawyer, doctor, social worker, nothing. So how do I go about it? So they said, but you know English. I said, yes, I do. And they said, you have connection to power and influence and money. You can bring that to the table. So I said, yeah, I can, but the struggle is really yours, even though you are poor and disenfranchised. And the same story that Shaheen Ji was talking about, tuberculosis, jaundice, AIDS, malnutrition, repeated abortions, suicide attempts, insomnia, skin diseases, constant fever from contact with so many men all the time. All the women were suffering from all of this. And I said, but you know, if you don't speak up, you know, how much can I speak up, and who's going to believe me? The struggle is yours. So they said, we don't know how. So I reminded them, I said that when I was making The Selling of Innocence, that's the name of my documentary, made 18 years ago, the women, somebody had pulled out a knife on me, and the women had surrounded me, 22 women, and they had told this man that if you want to kill her, you've got to kill us first. And the man thought it would be too much trouble to kill 23 women, so he slunk away, and they saved my life. So I said that, you know, we can save each other's lives if we organize across class, across caste, and let's try and take on issues together. So that's why then at that time I set up an NGO called Apne Aap Women Worldwide. Apne Aap, as most of you know here, I don't have to translate, means self-empowerment. And at that time, the women had four dreams. They said that they wanted school for their children. They said whatever had happened to them had happened, but they wanted a different destiny for their children. And that's why they had told their stories in my film. The second thing they said was they wanted a job in an office. And I asked them, I said, you know, if you see the brothels of Bombay or Calcutta, they are chawls. Wooden rickety hell holes with four or five beds shoved into one room, rats on the floor, iron bars on the window. You know, if you've read Manto, you'll know what they're like. And, you know, I couldn't imagine what did a job in an office mean to these women. So I asked them, and they said, oh, where we get, where we work 9 to 5, where nobody shouts at us and beats us, where we have a fixed monthly salary, you know, where it doesn't change. And I thought, of course, you know, that's absolutely right. You want, and old age pension. The third thing they said they wanted was, they said they wanted a room of their own. And I was an English literature student, so I couldn't understand that I was listening to Virginia Woolf in a brothel in Bombay. And I asked them, I said, a room of your own, what does that mean? And they said, bas itna bada, agar hame itni badi jagah bhi mil jaye, to hum sharab peena bhi chhod denge. Aur jahan par koi nahi aaye jab unka man kare, because customers can walk in when they want to. Jahan hamare bachche chup-chap janeen pe khel sakein, jahan hum so sakein jab hamare ko jab sona ho. So they wanted a room of their own. And the fourth thing they wanted was justice. And I asked them, I said, what does justice mean to you? Again, it was so remote, you know, the brutality, the violence, the utter destitution ki justice, to mujhe samajh bhi nahi aa raha tha ki inke liye justice kya hota hai? What is their definition of justice? And they said ki, two things. They said ki, we want those who have brokered away our dreams, who bought us and sold us, to be punished, and we want protection. There was nobody to watch out for us when we were pulled out of school and put into a brothel. So based on these four dreams, we started Apne Aap. And you know, now it's 14 years later since Apne Aap was a legally registered NGO. And Apne Aap has now reached out and organized more than 20,000 girls and women in prostitution across the red light areas of India. From Bombay, where I first encountered the problem, to my own hometown, Calcutta, Sonagachi, to Bihar on the border of Nepal, where the girls were trafficked from, to Delhi, or across the country. And now we also mentor organizations who have started, inspired by the Apne Aap approach, in South Africa, in a township called Langa. In Swahili, they coined a word which is the same as Apne Aap, which means Masifika Mani. In Idaho, with a group of Native American women. In Portland, Maine, with black women and survivors of prostitution. And so it's becoming a movement slowly. And what I found as I began to do the work was I began to listen, and Shaheen Ji was saying that, you know, nothing can beat going to the grassroots. And that's what I found, that, you know, everyone said you're a journalist, you have these connections with the UN and all of that, you should do advocacy. I said, but I can't do advocacy if I have nothing to advocate. And as a girl of shelter and privilege and education, actually a lot of my education taught me not to empathize with the poor. Mm. I didn't even know what they lived like. I'd never been inside a police station. So actually the women taught me so much. That the leader that I am today is because they gave me the leadership. Mm. And they shared their stories with me, and I could sit in a circle with them. And those circles have become larger and larger, and now I have a circle in Pakistan. So, you know, the circle goes across boundaries. But what I also found was that as I heard the stories of the women in Calcutta or Bombay, the stories were the same wherever I went. In France, in UK, in Sweden, in Norway, in Ireland, inside America. And, you know, I've been inside jails inside the United States where black children who are 14-year-old are crying their hearts out because they're put into prison for their prostitution. And there's no shelter to put them in. And they are called bad girls. So the reason I started with my story from Sonagachi and colonialism to what's happening in our new neoliberal world, the patterns are similar. You know, what happened in 19th century is being repeated without us noticing it. And one of the big dangers which is happening is that now we are being told that we should legitimize the exploitation of women as sex work. Mm. So we are not even allowed to call it exploitation anymore in the neoliberal regime. And that's a big battle. And the same solutions which were there under British colonialism are being visited on us again. For example, in Sonagachi, where I work, there's been a huge, and globally too, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation have funded a huge AIDS control program all over the world. And that program is basically to protect male buyers of prostitution from disease rather than protecting the women and girls from the male buyers. The program funds salaries of pimps and brothel keepers to go and distribute condoms inside red light districts. But they will not fund the education of little girls. They will not fund the basic needs of women like health, food, housing, shelter, nothing. All they do is fund the condom distribution. Because the 45-year-old men manning the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the consultants from McKinsey who they hire, who design these programs, all want to promote and sell products, and they're thinking of other 45-year-old men who are their demographic. So they're creating policies for each other, and I stood up to that, because today's topic is that how do we face wrongs and correct rights and make it right? So one of the biggest wrongs that I find in our current world is the accepting of the sexual exploitation of women in prostitution and our policy thrust to call it sex work, to challenge organizations like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and make them change their policy and say that this is going to perpetuate the problem, not end it. And, you know, Fouzia is going to be speaking after me, so I have the best person to follow who's challenged big institutions of power, stood up to them and taken it on. But the one learning that I've had in these 18 years of struggle with the grassroots women and then with global feminist allies across the world in changing laws and policies has been that if you break the silence and if you speak up, you find you have more friends and allies than you think. And we can actually take on people who we think we are very, very powerful. We think so. For example, Bill Gates seemed to be the richest man in the world, very powerful. There was no question of getting him to course correct. You know, he created a policy. It was being funded for $100 million across the world in 15 years. Everyone was using the term sex worker. But today, the Gates Foundation has stopped funding that program. And, you know, the only way I was able to do it was to build feminism across boundaries and find friends and allies who would embarrass him inside America. So the power of dialogue and the power of speaking up has been very important to me, and also the power of carrying and amplifying the voice of the last girl, as I call her, the 13-year-old in the brothel, to the top, to always speak truth to power.
Thank you very much. Could you please, Fouzia, share briefly about your wonderful book? I mean, very, it shook everyone, especially men. Taboo. And how far do you think we have come to accept women who are being merchandised because of their poverty or what all. Some words on that, please.
Sure. It was very interesting. Thank you very much for sharing so much in such a little time. I think it's almost like you've talked for an hour, just in terms of the intensity of it. But I want to add a little bit, and then I want to take up the same theme from a different angle later. I was researching the traditional system of prostitution, which is a little different from the brothel system. And I was looking at Lahore's Heera Mandi. And I was trying to, my whole journey began with my love for dancing. And I was very surprised that such a beautiful and I would say sacred, you know, because I really look at a beautiful dance and I sit and I cry. So such a beautiful thing, and why is it stigmatized? So my initial questioning started from there. And that question was in my head since I was 4 or 5 years old, when at weddings people used to push me back because I wanted to just go on dancing all the time. So it was, this whole journey was like about us kind of journey, you know, it was not about them. So I saw that people, you know, wherever there is dancing, they say, kya kanjar khana khula hua. So there was a connection that I wanted to explore. That is what led me to this red light area, my love for music. And then I discovered just so many things that I was not even expecting, you know, the power relations and the abuse and all that. But my search kind of took me to the roots of it, and to the creation of good women and bad women, and to even the creation of this concept of red light areas. So I went back into the history, and you have mentioned some things that they were very organized brothels for military people. And I went earlier than that. I think it was like I found documentation 300 BC kinds of things that were very, very systematic manuals of how it was supposed to be running for officials and who had the right on virginity and who was the second to have the right on virginity, and those kinds of rules very, very clearly spelled out. For me to realize that it was really an arena, a playground that was created very meticulously, and it is not that it's an unfortunate thing that happens, but people did design it quite well. And the desire to keep your good women away from any creative thinking and creative and reflection and dreaming, you kind of pull away all the creativity for the good woman and then allow the other kind of women to be creative because you need that, and then label them bad. I mean, I'm doing it, I'm condensing it, but this kind of a theory evolved from my own research. Now, I don't want to prove it or disprove it, but that is what emerged for me, that my God, you know, the bias that I was able to pick out, you know, other than the suffering that went on, was that our kind of people, you know, my research really turned into what we are doing rather than what those women are doing or the pimps are doing, because I felt like we all are not looking at this whole scenario as two people engaging in I could say consensual to a certain extent act, because we all have swear words related to one party and we don't even have a name for the other party. And we call the residential area for one party the red light area, and we do not call anything for the area where the other party lives. So it's very odd. You start seeing the drama, the bias, that we all are so focused on the victim and consider them the bad people, and we don't even have a single word for the guy who goes there, you know, let alone the swear word, but we don't even have a word for that. So, you know, that whole thing educated me a lot. I mean, for me, it was a personal journey. I did not even think about writing a book until very later in the process. Because it was like my whole life I had lived, even though I was a fighter, like Shaheen was saying, since my childhood. But you know, you learn about this drama that is going on about ethics and, you know, the ivory pedestals and and what is being good, and who sets the standards and who sets the measures. And so it all kind of fell for me, and I was thinking, gosh, you know, we really need to do some research on ourselves as to how skewed our own morality is. So what it did for me was I think that after that study, I just stopped taking anybody's standards of what is good.
Very good.
You know, I said, I will determine what is good or bad for myself. Thank you very much. And also, I realized that we, sort of the good women in the mainstream society, are as much imprisoned and abused as the bad women, because they are a victim of one side of the circus and we are the victims of the other side of the circus. So if now, especially, you know, I work in the field of culture, and dancing and performing arts is still tabooed. Until you have a protection of your families and your tight circles, and so it survives in pockets, it still bleeds my heart, because I feel like we have not done enough research and enough breaking the facades and this very skewed morality of the good people. So I feel sorry also, and I feel like, you know, gosh, you know, we still continue to believe in these facades. So that's my bit on the.
Thank you very much. I'd like to just because the topic is foreign wrong, facing wrongs and seeking rights. It goes beyond, actually. It goes beyond only the prostitutes. I think it really takes on women also. We don't talk about incest. Incest is there. Like it or not, we might be very religious, we might all go to heaven, but incest is there. Only last week, a father raped his daughter in Dhaka, threw her in the fields to die, but in the morning a farmer picked her up and took her to hospital, and then he went to hospital to try to kill her. The people from the hospital called the police. But why is it not decreasing? Because of the silence. We do not like to talk about things which we think society won't like, this decadent society won't like. We don't talk about child abuse, especially if it's concerning women. Raped women are condemned. If a friend of mine or yours, mine won't get raped, she's too old. But anyway, if a friend or a young girl gets raped or anything, we look down on her instead. A divorced woman, we protect her husband, he might run away with her. These attitudes, both my friends have indicated that stop labeling others. I agree that we have to break this silence. We have to be the voice of the voiceless. What do you think about these other issues where women are so subjugated? Why is it worse in this subcontinent than most other places?
Two reasons from my understanding. One is that child marriage, and so girls are married early and they lose their voice because they have to give birth to children before they have given birth to themselves. And so they don't have the power to, or the self-confidence to negotiate anything. And the is this better? And then the second thing is that in our subcontinent, we have what is known as a patrilocal culture, which is where girls marry and go to the husband's home. So they always live in a sense of permanent exile, because at home you're told that this is your father's house and you're going to, you know, you have to behave well, not cross your legs, sit like this, don't spread your legs, etc. Don't laugh too loudly, because you have to learn and practice how you're going to live in your husband's house. And when you're in your husband's house, it's your husband's house. So you are a guest from your father's house there. So women never have a home of their own. And because of that too, they always fear, the one fear that women have is the roof over our head. And you know, Shaheen ji started by talking about that, that the woman who came, who was thrown out because she had tuberculosis, she couldn't stay in her in-laws' house and she couldn't go back to her own house. So which was her house? where did she slip through the cracks and what was her entity? So this is something because of which a lot of silencing happens, is because women worry and girls worry that if they speak up, then either they will not be married, otherwise, they will not be accepted, they will be devalued, the shame, guilt and fear is always theirs for speaking up. So this is also connected to the very, very practical thing of a roof over their heads, or a room of their own, which the women were talking about to me. And this is one of the reasons. The other is that, the messaging through media, through our culture, traditionally over years, that a girl who's sexually abused, she is considered the bad girl. And, this is the messaging that is given to us again and again and again in any form by our family members at home, by media messaging, by movies that we watch, even sometimes by proverbs in our society. So, this kind of messaging also silences the girls. And when they try to become witness to abuse, speaking up on their own behalf or somebody else's behalf, then they are told, you're sort of breaking the family equilibrium, you're breaking the equilibrium of community, you're breaking up the ties of community and family. So the burden becomes on the little girl who was abused, and she finds it very hard to speak up because of that. But I want to end with just one quick hope, note of hope, that in India, this continued so much and child sexual abuse is rampant. So whenever I do any workshop, I ask people in the workshop, how many people have been abused? Everyone's hands goes up. But nobody's talked about it till the workshop happens. So obviously it's very, very, very rampant. And one kind of abuse then normalizes other kinds of abuse, and all of you are reading in the newspapers about the constant rapes in India, three-year-old babies being raped, journalists being raped, paramedical students going home in a bus being raped. So what it does is it also normalizes the culture of rape in public places, because abuse then becomes normalized itself. Women get devalued, and therefore, when that brutal bus rape happened on 16 December, all of us felt enough was enough, and we actually broke the silence. So we marched on the streets and boys and men joined us, and we told them, no, it's our movement, you all stay at the back and we want to be water cannoned. So we were moving out and we were asking, the slogan of our movement was Bekhof Zindagi, which means life without fear. And we were saying, we don't want to be just get the freedom to be good wives or good sisters or good mothers. We want the freedom to go out at midnight to buy a cigarette if we want to. And that debate, and we broke the taboo, around our bodies. We started talking about kisne hamara pallu khincha, kisne hame kahan poke kiya. Girls started blogging about their sexual abuse by the editors, their fathers, their bosses, judges who were, looking at interns. And the silence was broken. And that is now changing the culture of India. Because it really is, there's a new conversation going on in India. And right now you're reading about the rapes constantly, but that's also a success of our movement, because we are reporting it, we are speaking up about it, and we are winning case after case. We've changed the law. So, in 10 years, I think there will be change on that front for sure.
What is your take on this? Okay. Because, Fouzia, what pains me is that recently a very prominent and eminent and very great legislative assembly passed in few hours tax evasion sort of a thing. But when it came to child marriages, they threw it out. What should we do? How should we put the pressure? Because all of us sit here grumbling, but there is no collective voice against child marriages, which is continuing. 20% of our women get marriage before they're 16 married off. Please.
Okay. I'll share a little bit about the legislation that we got passed and the lessons from that. That probably would help. I was very engaged in a legislation on sexual harassment, but that turned out to be, I think, up till now, about a 13-14 year long process. It started with me going through an experience which was kind of unbearable for me in a UN office where we were supposed to be very civilized, and you also know about the whole case, and a very well-paid, well-respected guy was engaged in that. But I'm just going to highlight the lessons so that we come to answer your questions. One learning for me after going through that experience was that I experienced it for 3 years. I loved my job and it seemed that resigning was the only option and I didn't want to resign. And that's why I put up with it. And he was so close to the big boss, a darling boy, that I felt like there was no way that anybody would take action. So the only option for me is to resign. And I didn't want to do that. So 3 years I put up with it before I raised my voice. And when I did, I realized that he was treating every woman in the office like that. So the lesson for me was that we women worked with each other, but we never knew that he was doing exactly the same phrases, the same words to all of them, and we didn't know about it. And it was only when we, you know, when we started talking, then we were, like, the organization had 100 people, 16 women. He was treating all of them like that. And 11 of us got together to file the complaint. You know, again, the next thing is that we thought, you know, we were being now together and solidarity and brave. And the way the whole system reacted, they kind of labeled us as witches and really bad women, and suddenly we were respected colleagues and nobody even wanted to say salam to us. So that was another lesson, that the system will react. It is not the individuals that react, because the system is designed in a way, jo aap keh rahe the ki compliance, you know, you don't disrupt the system. So if there is a status quo, if there is a power imbalance, then you maintain that imbalance, otherwise you will be the one who will be punished. And anyway, later that case went on for 2 years. But what happened, the upside of that case was that in the UN system, a whole series of reforms started to brew up. And then in Pakistan, we started a movement called ASHA, Alliance Against Sexual Harassment, in year 2000. And we started joining up different stakeholders, women first, working women first, women from rural areas, farmers, factory workers, etc., gradually, you know. And then men also joined, progressive men first, and later we talk to them about, to other men, about their daughters and making the society a better place. And gradually, it took us about 10 years when we had the media with us and labor unions and many other stakeholders with us. It is a very hard process. But when we started lobbying with the parliament, I just want to share some highlights, because that's the parliament is what you're talking about. When we started dealing with the government at the time, it was Musharraf Saab's time, the government didn't want to sit on the table with us because they thought we were so vulgar to be using the word sexual. What kind of women could these be who would use the word sexual? And so because we really wanted the government sitting there, we wanted it to come for the whole country and not just a small initiative. So we had to change. We decided to change. And we called our anti-sexual harassment policy a code of conduct for gender justice. And they were able to swallow that and they came on the table. You know, so one needs to constantly strategize to bring people on board, because we cannot bring everybody on board 100%, but we have to bring them on board to the extent where our process goes forward. So the private sector initially was very, very suspicious about us, because we had evolved a policy, and we would go to the private sector and say, do you have this problem? They would say yes, and we would say, okay, how do you deal with this? And they would say, we fire them both, because we can never figure out who's telling the truth. Okay, you want to try this other solution? You know, we have evolved it and it will work. And they were very suspicious, but we learned their language and we learned their mindset. And we learned that they do not want to talk about women. They do not want to talk about human rights at all. Like, we were trained as activists. So we changed our language, and in order for them to understand, and that is, I think, the point I'm coming to, that we have to rephrase our things for the other sector to understand. So we started talking about job satisfaction. We started talking about having a productive organization. We started talking about having an image of the... and on, because they understood management employee. Okay, so we said the code of conduct is for both. Because dignity, everybody should have their dignity. So we rephrased our policy and we said this is no man or woman should be sexually harassed. We are fine with that, you know. So then they became very receptive, and by the time we were ready to go to the parliament, there were already about 350 good big private sector organizations who had the system implemented and it was working there. So this was one law that got implemented before it was presented. But with the parliamentarians, that was the hardest part, because first they used to judge us, you know, they would actually look at us and think, what kind of women are they? They're talking about sexual harassment. And so we always used to go together, etc. But I think that eventually what got us through was building a credibility, making them think that now you are in the position where you can change the world for your children, you know, make it cleaner and better for your children. And it took us about 3 years to get their mindset. And I think that is what we need on child marriage also, to make a larger base to push for it.
You see, taking on from what Fouzia said, we all grumble and want a utopian state. How many of you lift your hand and write a letter protesting about the status of women in Pakistan? No one. You should write to the Prime Minister. I know he can't read, but you can send notes. Of course, your the President, who is from your great city, he's got other likes rather than human rights. But anyway, you have to protest. And that is half the game, that your silence is keeping women down. More than half women are illiterate. We have the highest stillbirths now. We are only battling to get the last position with Mali and Senegal. We have 19% secondary school for girls in for percentage in Pakistan, 80% in Bangladesh, whom we looked about, kale chote. We have to get our things right. We keep on throwing it at the government. The government's officials, the bureaucrats, the grade 22, are, sorry to say, shit scared of their wives. Have you lobbied with them? Have you written to them? Men are okay, they are naughty and they can be raped. They can't be raped except in certain provinces. But anyway, women are. Now we have to ourselves try to make this a better country. No one is going to come from the Mars and fix it up. So where are our responsibilities? We keep on throwing it at UN or whatever. It's our country, our soil. And remember, Malaysia is Muslim, Indonesia is Muslim. Stop looking at the Arabs. Look at these progressive countries and make a difference. Question and answer, please. Please, question and answers, not from me, these two. Madam. Ji, a Maulvi speaking, excellent.
No, I'm not a Maulvi, I'm a liberal. I just want to have your opinion on three points, the three different points. There's a very popular book, a very brave non-fiction book called My Feudal Lord, where it is mentioned that the elite woman practice for getting power. The second point is, kids in half of our country, small kids, and in madrasas, their male kids are sexually abused. What about them? Who's going to talk about them? And the third thing, on a lighter side, when we send our cricket teams somewhere, so we send the wives with them so that they don't get naughty. So when the armies go, why don't they send the wives with them?
Because they're not naughty. Fouzia?
Okay. My Feudal Lord, I take that as a book which gives you raw data about a case study. Not analyzed data, but raw data about a case study.
Four, five
cases. But mostly, you know, one. And this power, the status quo of the power includes men and women, where women are party to the suppression, either through socialization or through whatever meager benefits that are associated with it. And in general, you see that in our society, even today, if, for example, one woman is being sexually harassed, you would see there is a lot of pressure on the other women to side with the men and be buddy-buddy with them and say, oh my God, she was like... It is very difficult for them to come out and stand in solidarity with the victim woman or survivor. So that is a part of it. It's a whole sociological circus. Your second question about madrasa kids, yes, a very big issue. I mean, I have issues just having madrasas because I don't think children should be separated from their parents. I think we should have a law about that. Children should not be separated, regardless of what. But this law that we got passed on sexual harassment and sexual abuse, we went overboard with making sure that they have the word person and not woman.
Okay.
Because we wanted to include what you're talking about. And so therefore it is covered in the law.
I think you need to clap for that. Yeah.
People can take cases for that. And your third point was? I knew it would.
Where about the army?
I think people know the answer to that. But I must make a, I mean, I'm not answering your third question, but I must make a point that it is such a casual kind of a likable naughtiness that people joke about it. And I'm really surprised at this bias. If a Pakistani actress goes to India and does a film and does whatever kinds of scenes, people are ready to roast her. And if a guy goes... It's quite okay. So that bias, we all need to do a lot of self-reflection.
I think you are totally right. I mean, if a man gets... the man is never blamed for anything. And that is our pity. And women have the longer tongues than the men, sorry to say. And it is our gossiping habit of making fun of other women and not looking at ourselves. So that is an issue. You see a man who... runs around, he's called a flirt. But if a woman blinks her eyes at someone, she's a badmash straight away. So we have to keep our tongues in check. We should not moralize on others. This is the biggest thing we want to put across. Any other, no woman going to ask any question?
Yes.
Ji. Piche, 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 piche. Mic piche le jana, kaki.
Oh, I have the mic.
No. Okay.
I was first.
How do you know?
Because I asked for a mic while he was speaking.
Oh, okay.
And I would like to speak about something that irritated me a little bit, is that you mentioned the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Now it's Bill and Melinda Gates, right? Melinda Gates is a woman. And she, I know for a fact that it's not just a catchy title. She didn't just fund it. She's working there. And she calls herself Melinda French, just so that she doesn't get associated with her husband. And she, up until recently, she was forcing herself to go and work with the same things that her husband is doing, which is, by and large, a health and scientific point of view. It's not about, it does do things about
question,
education.
Question, please.
And
we want a question.
Okay, I'm sorry. My question was that, actually, I mean, how can you look at big institutions sitting miles and miles away and ask them to help us? I prefer that what the moderator said about us empowering ourselves. So it's not really a question, it's just a clarification.
Thank you very much. It's a good clarification. But now Bill Gates and Melinda are a bit in a soup because they developed mosquitoes to kill the malaria mosquitoes, and the ruddy malaria mosquitoes have flirted with the malaria mosquitoes and got this parasite all called the Zika. So that is killing people by the millions. We were thinking of importing it here because there's so many children. Ji.
Can I just, I just want to give one comment to her, because I think she asked a really good question, that when we work at the grassroots, do we really need to engage with the big institutions far away? Sometimes we do, because the impact of their policies are at the grassroots. So when I was working in the Sonagachi red light area, and I would go to a police station and I would say such and such brothel keeper is holding this 19-year-old woman hostage, I would be told this is NGO rivalry because that brothel keeper is a peer educator funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. So unless I was able to change the top, you know, I could work at the bottom, but the bottom would keep being reinvented by these people. So we always have to constantly do the top. Change begins at the bottom, but it must transform at the top. That's why we have to understand, and what she was talking about, the mosquito nets, you know, that the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, when they think about top-down solutions and they create these one-size-fits-all solutions for people, in they wanted to help some countries in Africa with ending malaria. So they gave Maasai's in Tanzania, they gave them mosquito nets, and they don't use beds. So they began to use the mosquito nets for fishing, and the mosquito nets were so fine that they picked up the eggs of the fish along with the fish, and so next year's crop was destroyed.
Oh my God.
So the bottom and the top are interconnected.
I'm Dr. Noor Zahir from Delhi. I just wanted to know one thing. What do we expect from the governments then? If they are not going to give us protection, if they are not going to take care of our women, they are not going to punish the culprits, the criminals, they're not going to build roads, they're not going to give us foods, they're not going food, they're not going to give us jobs, they're privatizing everything. And we go on absolving them that the governments are not responsible. We should be taking things in our hands. Well, a lot of you are. A lot of us are. I mean, you're just three of you here, but there's so many more who are doing things in small ways to change things, and they're not changing because the top level is not taking responsibility. The things have to be changed, laws have to be changed, women have to be given equal rights, and they have to be given their lives.
I'd like to answer that because I'm a retired politician. The governments never like to change because they depend, their existence is on status quo. And culture is never changed by governments. It is us. It is society. It is us who has to make the difference. Look at the people we vote in. People who can't read. People who only make dahi badas. It is us who have to make a difference. And unfortunately, my country, I don't know India at all, except my ancestors came from there. But the biggest problem here is we do not encourage sharing of powers. The biggest problem is that we have more than half our population living in the rural areas. No one gets a hang about them. Our youngsters don't go because there's no AC. There are no internet connections. That divide is very serious, which is coming. The women in the rural area are worse off than anywhere else. Even worse than Africa. But we keep on making, I mean, you know what they did recently, I don't want to name the province, but anti-harassment laws, excellent laws made by Fouzia and those then women, they've put a woman there in charge of it who's anti-women. You know, the biggest anti-woman is the mother-in-law anyway. But they put this woman there now, and she is worse than anything else. So, forget the government, let us get the communities involved. Let us get people involved. Instead of having these coffee parties and these committee systems, we can make them into speaking the truth, getting women together, being a support to each other. That is where we have disconnected. So I hope that answers somewhat.
Just with an example, and I'll do a quick job of again summarizing it. I think that what has worked for us is to change our attitudes about the government and make the government change their attitudes about us, because for a very long time we have blamed the government and we have bashed the government. and I think that I personally want to put the responsibility for the things that the government has to do on them and not have us hide behind that. Our media does that too much. You know, even a bomb blast by a Taliban group is the fault of the government and is the fault of the school management, which didn't provide enough zarra bakhtar to every school kid or something. So that line, I will give you an example. When we were doing the sexual harassment legislation, we wanted the government to be a party. We had a very hard time. We took the longer route, but we wanted the ownership. Now, one thing that was different that we did was that civil society is only used to bashing the government. We did not. And we got the media, and the minute the process entered the government arena and they owned the bills, for 3 years we never said that we wrote the bills or we did the bill. We said the government is considering this, the government is considering this, and this is a very good idea, and we should. And when the bills were passed, because the stakeholders were so together, we did a nationwide applaud for them. Now the parliament, for the parliament, it is unthinkable to have an applaud, let alone nationwide applaud. And suddenly the doors opened, because they, you know, after all, it is the parliament. We can only bring the proposals. We can convince them. But because of that, because of the headlines on the newspaper saying the parliament, and we had these little signs, geo parliament, etc., that they opened the doors and they said, okay, if you want to bring more, you can bring more. So everything that was in the pipeline, we finalized it fast and we pushed through. And it was like we knew that we had this magic tunnel for about, you know, it lasted for almost 3 years. And we were able to get seven laws, a total of seven laws passed in a three-year period, only because we teamed up. I think, because we teamed up and we were not adverse to them, we were not bashing them. And I will tell you that these laws were, we had positive laws for women, beneficial laws, after a gap of almost 50 years. And then we had seven laws. So that I think that we need to strategize more.
Thank you very much. And as the time has, one more question. Because we've gone over time and Amina is here, she might hit me.
I wasn't there in the beginning of the session, so perhaps you addressed this issue.
Who's asking this question?
I wanted to ask about the rising incidence of rape in India. This is quite out of character for the Indian people. So what do you think are the factors that have led to this situation? Thank you.
I can't see you. Okay, I can see you now. So, you want to know why there's increased rape in India? I was saying that I don't think there's more increased rape in India. It's just that more women are reporting the rapes now. Because we have a very strong women's movement on our hands right now, which is quite exciting. And women have decided to break the silence.
Very good.
Courage is contagious. So when one woman speaks up, a second speaks up, a third speaks up, and now it's spread like wildfire across our country. So everyone's learning from each other, and therefore we are having more incidents of reporting. But the other thing which is happening, which I do want to mention, I think which is probably similar to our countries, is that there is a new kind of masculinity which is being promoted across the world, and in both our countries also. And that masculinity is not of the gentleman. Gentle is the word I want to use here. But the masculinity is of someone who's very aggressive, who's dominating. If he can't be the breadwinner, at least he can be the person who's violent. And this is being promoted in many different ways. One is through the cult of militarization, but the other is also through pornography. And pornography is available to 12-year-olds on the internet now through SIM cards which are available for 20 rupees in cigarette shops. And the porn narrative is where a man is penetrating a woman in every part of her body. He's crying. She's in pain and she's saying, give me more. So he's mixing up sex with violence. And this also is creating a new kind of masculinity. Even the men who went and did the bus rape, they'd watched porn on their cell phone before going out. So we must understand that this masculinity, this new kind of masculinity which is being promoted, where people are going out in gangs and raping girls, this misogyny, which is considered a part of masculinity, this is something new. And in all our cultures, this is something new. It's only about 100 years old. And we have to challenge that, and we need the men. Most men are not violent,
Most men are not buying sex. Most men are not indulging in incest. So why not get those men to start speaking up? Excellent. I think we have to get them to start speaking.
We didn't have a word for rape in Pakistan, and now we have coined a word, and we are doing a big campaign called Inkar against rape. So we have the word Zabar Jinsi, because we were very upset with the kind of phrases that we use for rape. Zabar Jinsi, so Inkar Zabar Jinsi Se, that is the campaign. So I would strongly encourage you to use not Izzat Lut Jana, Ya Ismat Rezi, Ya Zanabil Jabar, all of them are very silly and very odd. So use Zabar Jinsi instead.
Thank you. Last question, because the young gentleman, good-looking cutie pie, is glaring at me. Gee.
Okay, there's this one question, please, for Ma'am Fouzia. You are aware of the child abuse that is going on with so-called upholders of organized religion. Is there a plan in your mind? How are you going to tackle it? Because everybody is aware of it and it's been going on, but there seems to be nothing on it so far. And another one for Ma'am Gupta. What did you do? How did you then make those women who were able to get empowered, how did you help them become more productive? Because I think it's economic depravity that is behind all this to begin with. So short, these two questions.
Short answers. Mm-hmm. Yep.
I am more focused on women, I would be very frank, but I think that the parents need to start a movement for the children.
Absolutely. Ji.
Or himmat.
Not education. The educated are the worst. Ji, please.
I can think exposing is what she's talking about, like just breaking the silence and exposing. But in my own work, you know, yes, on prostitution and the exploitation of women is a combination of two things. One is sexism on one side and the other is poverty on the other side, right? So all these systems are based on both supply and demand. Supply is formed of women and girls who lack choices. So they are poor, they are female in India, they are low caste here, they are of certain ethnicities. Plus, they are teenagers. So the intersecting inequalities makes them vulnerable to the traffickers. But on the other hand, there is the demand. Who is buying the girls? And what is the word that we have for these men who are coming and buying sex with 15-year-old, 14-year-old girls who create the demand so that traffickers, the pimps, the brothel keepers see a profit in it? So we are now trying to change laws all across the world to go after the demand. So to punish the buyers of prostituted sex, to punish the traffickers, and even the abusers, you know, to shift the blame from the victim to the perpetrator. And that's why the book also that I brought out, I've called it The Prostituted Woman in Indian Fiction, because language is politics. And if we begin to use different language, we will bring into our consciousness who is doing it.
Thank you very much. A round of applause for both. And let us start by thinking. Let us start from today, stop talking against any human being. Ji, Kishwar, you would like to say?
Nazam suna do.
Nazam, Nazam, Nazam suna rahi hai. So, 2 minutes over my time. Ji, something with hope.
Hamari ustad aur hamari inspiration, Kishwar Nahir.
इधर आ जाएं बैग हटाओ
यही खड़े होके सुना देती हूँ बहुत दूर है बहुत हजारों दफा सुनाई लेकिन जो बातें ये कह रही हैं उसी के को कंक्लूड करने के लिए उन्होंने कहा कि ये सुना दें कि ये हम गुनाहगार औरतें हैं जो अहले जुब्बा की तमकनत से जिस लौंडों की बात कर रहे थे ये हम गुनाहगार औरतें हैं जो अहले जुब्बा की तमकनत से न रोक खाएं न जान बेचे न सर झुकाएं न हाथ जोड़ें ये हम गुनाहगार औरतें हैं कि जिनके जिस्मों की फसल बेचे जो लोग वो सरफराज ठहरे नियाबत इम्तियाज ठहरे वो दावरे अहले साज ठहरे ये हम गुनाहगार औरतें हैं कि सच के परचम उठा के निकले तो झूठ से इशाराएं अटी मिले हैं जो बोल सकती थी वो जुबानें कटी मिले हैं हर एक दहलीज पे सजाओं की दास्ताने रखी मिले हैं ये हम गुनाहगार औरतें हैं कि अब ताकुब में रात भी आए तो ये आंखें नहीं बुझेंगी कि अब जो दीवार गिर चुकी है इसे उठाने की जिद ना करना ये हम गुनाहगार औरतें हैं जो अहले जुबा की तमकनत से न रोब खाएं न जान बेचे न सर झुकाएं न हाथ जोड़े. औरत जिंदाबाद.
जबरदस्त.
औरत जिंदाबाद.